Dear participants at the school of at the annual school of Byzantine studies. My name is Andrei Prohin. I am a researcher at the Institute of History in Chișinău in the Republic of Moldova. And I would like to speak now about the Byzantine world chronicles that were known in the Romanian principalities. I think it is an important part of the Byzantine heritage. This because of the dozens of manuscripts that were preserved in Greek, Slavonic, Romanian, which witnesses the interest that medieval people had towards this kind of literature. The world chronicles, which are also called chronographies, don't deal only with history. It is well known that these works have an encyclopedic nature. They touch also other topics related, for instance, to geography or to church life, to theology. And perhaps this is the reason why they were so widespread. There are different ways of studying world chronicles. I have remarked that in the recent years, there is an increased interest among Byzantinists towards world chronicles. I shall focus now only on one perspective of research, and namely on the eschatological message of world chronicles. Eschatology, it is well known, is a very big topic, and studies on it are already made for several decades. And of course, the Byzantine world chronicles have already been remarked and used in this sense. What I try to bring new in this field. As far as I know, the world chronicles the translations of Byzantine world chronicles that were known in the Romanian principalities weren't so deep investigated from the point of view of their content and of their reception among the Romanians. Because I'm interested in the eschatological message of these chronicles, I shall try in my presentation to reveal firstly these kinds of information that refer to eschatology. And at the end, I shall try to answer how this message could be understood among the readers of this chronicle in the Romanian principalities, and especially in Moldova. According to the late Romanian philologist Gheorghe Mihailă, the first stage of reception of Byzantine world chronicles belongs to the 15th, early 17th century, when these works were spread in Slavonic translations. They were made by South Slavic scholars and were spread to the north of the Danube in the Romanian principalities, as well as in Russia. You can see here the authors whose works are attested in manuscripts from this area. It is Patriarch Nikephoros, George the Monk, Simeon Logothet, John Zonaras, and Constantine Manasses. We know that there were translated into Slavonic also other chronicles, for instance, that of John Malalas or of George Sinkelos, but they weren't attested in manuscripts from the Romanian principalities. It is good to bear in mind the fact that only a small part of the medieval manuscripts has survived up till now, so that it is not excluded that the works of other authors also were known among the Romanians. I chose to speak only about one chronicle in my presentation. It is the chronicle of attributed to Simeon the Logothete. It was preserved, the whole Slavonic translation was preserved only in one manuscript that is now held by the Russian National Library from St. Petersburg. Fortunately for me, it was published at the beginning of the 20th century, and so I could consult it. This manuscript is also remarkable by the fact that it is one of the very few manuscripts for which where is indicated who and when copied it. It was a copy ordered by the Metropolitan of Moldova, Anastasie Crimca, but the whole work was finished after his death. It was finished in 1637. The title of the chronicle can be translated into English like that: Account of the World from the Creation and Chronicle Collected from Different Chroniclers by Simeon Metaphrastes and Logothetes. But the manuscript, in fact, contains two works, the works of two authors. One is the Chronicle of Simeon Logothete until 948. According to the specialists who studied it, it reflects the first redaction, Greek redaction, of this chronicle, a redaction which is favorable to Nikephoros Lekapenos. But the translation wasn't made according to the original, but basing on a Greek intermediary. And about one third of this manuscript contains an information about taken from the history of John Zonaras, but abridged one. When one reads the Chronicle of Simeon Logothete, as well as other Byzantine world chronicles, one finds a lot of stories that, for, so to say, positivist historians, have no sense. In many histories of medieval literature, we find this cliché that these chronicles contained many curious anecdotes, many legends and superstitions, and so on, without going deeper into the content of these episodes. I propose in my presentation a reading of these, at the first sight, scattered episodes, beginning from the idea that many of them can reflect an eschatological concern. And namely, we can observe that the author was very interested about the way how different emperors died, and he emphasized this by retelling different dreams or portents that announced their death, or he made judgments that, for instance, an emperor died in a manner that was that he deserved, and this we can consider to reflect a part of the individual eschatology that deals with the fate of the individual. And we also meet several references veilless ones that refer to the end of the world. I shall refer further only to those that refer to the end of the world, because they are less, for a short presentation. One of the first eschatological references, in my opinion, we find already in the beginning of the Chronicle, where the author tells us about the descendants of Adam and Eve. And in one moment, in one passage, apparently, by the way, he says that Adam had predicted that the entire world would perish either through water or fire. And this is the reason why the nephews of Adam, that are the sons of Seth, decided to build two pillars, a stone one and a brick one, in case the world will perish through water, the stone one will remain. In case through fire, the brick one will remain. It is not an original information. It is retold also by previous authors. If we continue reading this chronicle, we see that Adam was right. In fact, the Lord wanted to destroy the entire world through a flood of water, and it did happen during Noah's time. At the same time, when we look at the second part of this prediction, it refers to a flood of fire. But in the New Testament, we have some references to the fact that the world will be destroyed by fire. In fact, it is a belief that we already meet in the ancient classical literature, and it was continued also in some apocrypha from the Middle Ages. One of the works that most vividly depicts this flood of fire is the apocryphal Apocalypse of John. By the way, in the Romanian folk beliefs that were recorded starting with the end of the 19th century, we also meet this belief that there will be another flood at the end of the world, but it won't be a water, but a fire one. It is good to look in what context this passage is presented. It is presented at the beginning of the chronicle, when is related the life of the first generations. One of the ideas that we can conclude from this is that already at the beginning of the world, it was known that the world will finally perish. That the world, that the history goes towards an end. And another conclusion is that in this passage, it is linked, this knowledge about the end of the world is exposed in the context of the origin of the astronomic wisdom. So the nephews of Adam wanted to preserve for the future generations their wisdom about the motion of the stars, because they knew that sometime the world can perish. If we look at the same passage from John Malalas, there is expressively said that they knew about the end of the world from high above. The next reference occurs in the account that refers to the reign of Octavian Augustus and the incarnation of Jesus Christ. Here, the author evokes the prophecy of Daniel, and he gives it an interpretation, saying that the beginning of the Roman Empire is in fact the fourth beast, the fourth empire that was predicted in the vision of Prophet Daniel. We know that it should be the last earthly kingdom, which will be followed by a fifth one, which will be eternal. And the author reminds us about this thing, saying that the eternal kingdom belongs to Jesus Christ, who was born during the reign of Octavian Augustus. I think an important it is important to notice here that the author stresses the fulfillment of biblical prophecies. He also says in the same context about the prophecy of Sibylla about the coming of Christ, as well as it is good to pay attention to these coincidences in modern languages, but there are four kingdoms prophesied by Daniel. There are four elements from which the world consists, and there are four edges of the world. These are traits that would suggest to the readers that things aren't just a coincidence, but they reflect a very keenly thought plan which was devised by God. Several pages later, we read about Emperor Domitian, who met some Christians, and he asked them when will come Jesus Christ, when the eternal kingdom will be. And they answered him that this kingdom doesn't belong to this world, it is a heavenly one, and it will come at the end of ages to judge the living and dead ones. The author makes an interesting portrait of Domitian. He shows us this emperor as a person very afraid about the future, very concerned to know about different predictions. And he tried during his reign to prove that these predictions are false. He made the chronicler tells us how he wanted to avoid these scenarios, but they came true. And we can conclude, referring to the prophecy about the coming of the Christ, that these two will come true like the previous ones. During the chronicle, we meet also some two cases when the author tells us about some natural catastrophes, when people from Byzantium said that it is the end of the world. There are only two cases when he tells us this thing. We may suppose that there were also many other catastrophes during the existence of the Byzantine Empire that shocked the people. But it is symbolic that he tells us only about these two. If we look at them, he speaks about the falling of stars and about a strong wind that shook houses and churches. And we can, if we compare it to the little apocalypse from the Synoptic Gospels, we see that there the Lord says that before the world end, there will be, the stars will fall, there will be earthquakes and other dramatic events. Also, he speaks in one passage about Constantine Copronymus, calling him a vessel serving the Antichrist. How can we understand this expression, a vessel serving the Antichrist? I think that he means that Constantine Copronymus was possessed by an evil spirit that refers to Antichrist. We can compare to the similar passage from George the Monk, where he directly says that this emperor was the forerunner of Antichrist. And another important idea that he suggests slightly is that the end can be averted through God's mercy. It is an idea that we find in many other sources. Finally, Simeon the Logothet recounts the meeting between Emperor Romanus Lecapenus and the Bulgarian Tsar Simeon. And he tells us how Romanus convinced Simeon to cease the hostilities against Byzantium. He reminded him that Simeon is also a Christian one, a Christian person, that he will answer for his deeds before the judge. If we look attentively at this passage, he speaks about resurrection and judgment. Perhaps this refers to the final judgment, but also he speaks about death, about passing to the other world. This refers to the individual life to the individual death of Simeon of Bulgaria. Analyzing this passage within the context, we see that the chronicler wanted to make a portrait of Romanus Lecapenus as a very good believer, a good Christian who before this important meeting prayed with tears, and he even wore the omophorion of Our Lady before meeting Tsar Simeon. And another idea that is implied in this passage is the fact that the meditation on the Last Judgment helps to avoid sin. It is an advice that we already meet in the writings of Church Fathers and of the Desert Fathers, beginning with the 4th century. I would like to conclude. If we assemble together all these references to the end of the world, we may remark that most of them aren't original ones. They were taken from other sources, but the general picture of the end of the world is a coherent one, and the author recalls the main landmarks from the church doctrine. He says that the Roman Empire is the last stage of the human history. He says that the end of the world will be foreshadowed by natural disasters, that at the end of the world, the Lord will come to judge the dead and the living ones, and also that it is worth praying for the mercy of God in order to avert the catastrophes from the end. I compared these ideas about the end of the world with a work that was written about the years when this copy was made. I compared it with the Confession of the Orthodox Church by Petru Movila, which was written in the 30s of the 17th century and was approved in Iași and in Constantinople. And while explaining the creed, Petru Movila tells us what we should know about the end of the world. He says that the Christians should believe that Christ will return in order to judge the living and the dead ones. He will return in glory. But before this, the gospel will be preached to all the nations. There will come the Antichrist. There will be wars, hunger, plague, and many other things. And to say shortly, there will be a very great trouble. It is almost the same scenario that the chronicler Simeon the Logothete mentioned apparently, by the way, in his offer. It would be good to know about, to have more testimonies about how this work was received in the Romanian lands, among the Romanian scholars. Unfortunately, we have very little data. We know from its final note that this manuscript was called briefly Metaphrastes. Well, as I have read, contemporary scholars debate whether Simeon the Logothete is the same person with Simeon Metaphrastes or not. But I think the medieval tradition has relevance here because being attributed to Metaphrastus, it showed to the readers of the age the authority of this book. It belongs to a well-known writer of church literature. We know that the book was, the manuscript was finished under the supervision of the superior of a Dragomirna monastery. Perhaps the manuscript belonged also to the library of this monastery. It is not the first Romanian monastic library of which we know that possessed world chronicles. Another example is the monastery of Bistrița from Oltenia. And Anastasie Crimca wasn't the only high representative of the high clergy to be interested in works of this nature. In the early 17th century, Bishop Teofil of Râmnic commissioned the translation of the first world chronicle in Romanian, using firstly the chronicle of Manasses, but also other authors, among them Simeon the Logothete. I think that this chronicle repeated some eschatological ideas that one finds in many other church writings of other genre, but it indicates them in its way. It is not a preach, like for example the homilies attributed to Hippolytus, Pseudo-Hippolytus of Rome, or to Saint John Chrysostom. It accounts these things more excitingly, to say so, in a modern language, and it shows the apocalyptic signs within historical events. It encourages to analyze historical evolutions from the perspective of the fulfillment of the apocalyptic scenario, where the scholars from the Romanian principalities also interested in this topic about the end of the world and the way how it is how it approaches during the history. I think a witness for this is the fact that some of the motifs, eschatological motifs that I mentioned in the Chronicle of Simeon Logothete, one finds also in the works of Romanian scholars like Nicolae Costin, Milescu Spătaru, or even Dimitrie Cantemir. I can't say now about, I don't have arguments to say that they were influenced by this chronicle that they of Simeon Logothete. They could take it from other sources, but it reflected a preoccupation of the age. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Andrei, for this interesting topic. Yes, yes, Anastasia.
Yes, I would have a question. So, since we are opening the discussion, you have said that. Can you hear me right? Yeah.
Yes.
So you have said that many eschatological motifs were taken from the Byzantine world, let's say. And so my question is about center and periphery. So, in what aspect can you say that these motifs represent Byzantine tradition, or it has also some local specific? So is it Byzantine eschatological literature in Slavonic phrases, let's say, and on Romanian soil, or is it some local eschatology, or is it a combination of both?
Yes. Well, from what I have studied, the greatest majority of works containing eschatological motifs are translations from the Byzantine literature into Slavonic, without changes made by Romanians. In comparison, for instance, with Bulgaria, where we have more and serious reworkings of this kind. On the other hand, Milescu Spătaru and Dimitrie Cantemir, they wrote their own works where they give interpretations of several eschatological motifs which are original interpretations. I refer to the work of Milescu Spătaru, Basilio Logion, and to the Treaty of Cantemir about the monarchies.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Do you have other questions, please? Yes, Sorina?
Can I ask a question also?
Yes.
I'm just curious. So the manuscript was in the collections of the Dragomir Monastery. Then you mentioned that now it is in the library in St. Petersburg. How did it get there? What is the history of the manuscript?
Yes, I don't. Thank you. I don't know how it got there. I haven't found such information in the editions which I consulted. We may suppose that maybe it followed the path of other manuscripts copied by Romanian scholars that are now abroad. Maybe it was robbed. Maybe it was bought in the 19th century by a collectioner from Russia or from other countries, and later it reached St. Petersburg. I should consult more catalogs. Maybe there will be indicated to whom belonged the fund where now this chronicle is preserved.